Hey there, it's Elina, your friendly nuclear physicist, and today we're doing our first Q&A in the nuclear fuel lab, based on the questions that you guys left in the previous video that's gonna be up right here in case you haven't checked it already. I'm gonna try and get into as many questions as I can. Without further ado, let's get straight into it. So the first question I have is, how is it to work in a nuclear power plant? And the scope and the annual income in the field of nuclear energy. I had to do some research about the annual income because of course it varies like any other engineering job or any other job in general. And it really has quite a big range. Anywhere from $70,000 to $150,000 is what Google suggests, which is, I would assume, quite close to reality. And this would answer basically the second question. However, the first one, how is it like to work in a nuclear power plant? I can't really tell because I do not work in a nuclear power plant. I work in a nuclear lab and it is quite different. And even in the nuclear power plant, there is different kinds of jobs that an engineer can do. You can be either an operator, someone who makes fuel, some person who is working at maintenance, or I don't know, a person who does some sort of software work. So it really is a very wide question, even though it might feel like a very narrow one. However, I don't have much experience in that. Working in a nuclear lab, on the other hand, is very interesting. It's very new and innovative work that we're doing here at the lab. So it's always challenging. It's not always easy, but it definitely pays off. So moving on to the second question. And I have, uranium is not dangerous, right? Why is it so overrated? It's nothing, right? Okay. Let's make something clear. Uranium is not harmless. We know that it is a natural element, and the one that I showed in my previous video is naturally occurring uranium, meaning that it's not enriched in any way, it's not activated in any way besides the natural radiation that it has by itself. Nevertheless, having said that, that does not mean that it is harmless, that you can just touch it, handle it as any other metal without knowing the potential dangers that it can cause to be exposed to this kind of materials. Therefore, it is dangerous to an extent as long as there is not enough knowledge about it. When you have knowledge about what the material is that you are handling and how you should handle it properly, then it is not as dangerous. But that doesn't mean that it is harmless or it cannot cause you harm if you don't know how to treat it properly. So I would say to that question, it is very important to have the knowledge on which materials you're working on and how each of them should be handled. So I got several times the question of how does it taste?
Bruh.
And I'm assuming how does a uranium taste? And I take this question hopefully as a joke, and I very strongly suggest and very strongly recommend to nobody trying to eat uranium and see how it tastes. Even though if I had to assume, I would say it probably doesn't taste anything different than trying to eat any other piece of metal. Another question is that what is the face mask actually good for? So I was wearing the face mask in the part of the video that I was taking out the piece of uranium and measuring its radioactivity. So there, the face mask was basically used in order for any dust particles or anything that could be lifted up from the piece and up in the air to not be inhaled or ingested or touching on my face, basically. And that would be the reason why we would use a face mask when treating such materials. When, for example, having a solid piece of uranium pellet that doesn't have any dust around it or is not going to have any dust being lifted in the air out of it, then not even a mask is necessary to be able to touch, for example, a uranium pellet. Only gloves in that case would suffice. However, if one handles, for example, powders, which are exactly the kind of materials that can get picked up in the air and can get ingested and inhaled by a human being who is handling the powders, then in that case, a respiratory mask is necessary. Eye goggles could also be used, and of course, everything should be inside the fume hood. But let me go ahead and show you how that will look like. So this is how we look like typically when we handle powders that contain uranium or any kind of other radioactive materials that can be picked up in the air and inhaled by the person who is handling them. And those kind of powders, If they can be handled outside in an oxygen atmosphere, then we handle them inside the so-called fume hoods, which are basically working areas in which the air is basically sucked inside and upwards. And if you are working and the fume hood is below the safety limit, that means that no air or particles is actually coming outside, so it's quite safe to work. If we need to transfer powders that contain uranium, we do transfer them looking like this. We have a respiratory mask which filters out all the dust, eye goggles in case some dust gets picked up in the ice. Double layering of gloves would also be helpful. The most important thing is to have the long gloves that would basically cover the sleeves, not leaving the wrist area being exposed. And now if one would want to handle, for example, some sort of chemicals, the process would look a little bit different. So if I was going to handle some acids, I would also wear this protection in case some spill from the acids happen, and special chemical gloves that would basically not be burned through so the acid doesn't touch the skin of the person who is handling them. Therefore, as you can see, you can have a lot of gear for depending on the kind of material you need to treat. However, it is important to know how dangerous is the material that you are planning to treat and what are the potential dangers that you can have from being exposed to it or contaminated by it, and choose the proper gear, the safety gear, to work. Over-gearing is also not useful and also not so safe sometimes, because if you're wearing a lot of unnecessary safety protective gear and you're handling something that is quite sensitive and you make a mistake or you cannot handle it properly because you're wearing so much excessive gear that is not necessary, it's also not good for your job and for the outcome you're trying to achieve. And also, it is pretty much unnecessary, and if you don't need it, then you should basically know which are the proper gear that one needs to wear in order to handle the particular material that we're interested in. That's why you saw me in the last video wearing the mask, only to basically measure the uranium, because I was not going to cut it or basically turn it to powder or anything like that that would have some more serious consequences in case I was going to get exposed to it. So I hope this clears up a little bit the air and the confusion and gives you some sort of reassurance that we do have all kinds of gear and even more than that in case it is necessary to wear them. However, we do understand the risks of each material we're handling and we choose the gear accordingly.
So another question I received is, can we see yellow cake and how is that different from the black powder that I talked about in the last video? So this is basically how the yellow cake looks like, which is a form of uranium oxide. And how is that different from the uranium dioxide that we're using to make the pellets? It is basically a different type of oxide. It's still uranium and it's still oxygen, just in different concentrations, in different atomic concentrations, that makes the color look different. The uranium dioxide happens to be gray, and the U2O3 yellow cake happens to be of a yellow color. However, as I said, this is the primary source out of which we therefore make uranium dioxide and then bake to make the pellets. So was your Geiger counter measuring uranium-238 or uranium-235? That seemed to be a very high reading, 500 microsievert per hour for uranium-238. So the Geiger counter measures different types of radiation, which can either be alpha radiation, beta, or gamma. It doesn't measure or can separate between different isotopes, such as uranium-238 and uranium-235. Therefore, what the Geiger measures is it measures the alpha particles that are emitted from the uranium isotope altogether, and also measures some beta and gamma radiation. The uranium that I was measuring in the previous video is a natural metal of natural uranium, meaning that, as I said before, it is pretty much 99.3% uranium-238, which is the majority of it, and only a very small percentage below 1% is uranium-235. So the value we saw of around 500 microsieverts per hour actually belongs to the natural uranium, which is mostly uranium-238. I got a question of how is that pretty much compared to something that is more understood by the public, for example, an X-ray. And in a typical X-ray, a dose that a person receives is around 100 microsieverts, and that would mean, since this is a total dose and the 500 microsieverts that we measured is a dose per hour. To elaborate more, since 500 microsieverts per hour means that if one stands at a very close proximity to the uranium metal, very close to as the detector was pretty much touching the metal piece, for a continuous hour, one would receive a dose of 500 microsieverts. But since we don't stand next to it for a continuous hour, and we're also much further away from it than the detector was, the dose is considerably low, it's orders of magnitude low. However, as a comparison, one would need to stand in a very close proximity, almost touching the piece, for a little bit less than 20 minutes in order to receive 100 microsieverts total dose, which would be approximately a dose that you would receive from an X-ray. Another question I got quite a lot is that people were concerned that the plastic Ziploc bags that I placed inside the glove box actually contain oxygen once you seal them. So when you pass them through the glove box, you still maintain a small atmosphere of oxygen inside the Ziploc bag, which is actually true. And that is why when we pass something from outside to inside the glove box that is inside the Ziploc bag, we don't fully seal the Ziploc bag and close it halfway or something, leaving a little bit of space. So when we pass it through the small tube and flush the vacuum and then introduce argon, the bag will basically be filled with argon. And once we transfer it inside the big area of the glove box, we can properly seal it, and then the bag will have inside argon in that case. I like how you caught on that though. This was a very small detail, and plenty of people commented on that, so I'm really glad that people actually caught up on it, that it would actually be the case, because it's quite an easy, let's say, mistake or thing to not think about and keep doing, and actually like this, perhaps over time oxidizing the materials that you think are sitting in a very inert atmosphere with no problem of oxidation. Okay, another question is, how do you change the gloves of the glove box? Those gloves look like they need to be replaced after some time. And that is true. These are thick rubber gloves. However, they can still rip or maybe have some small hole inside, which would basically mean that there can be oxygen going inside and the atmosphere of the glove box would not be as pure anymore. It is a little bit of a tricky procedure to replace them, since once they are removed from the glass of the glove box, oxygen will be introduced inside the glove box and the atmosphere will not be pure anymore. Therefore, in that case, one would need to remove all of the sensitive samples and powders that sit in the glove box into another glove box that we have here in the lab for a period of time until the replacement is successful. And when replacing the gloves and sealing them properly, one could start basically purifying again the glove box and taking out all the oxygen and introducing argon until the whole glove box is again filled with argon and the levels of oxygen are quite low in the ppm parts per million amount. And then one can transfer back again the sensitive materials inside the glove box. I got this question quite a lot, and what is basically the difference between the nitride and the oxide fuel? In my previous video, I talked that I am working mostly with uranium nitride fuels, and this is quite an innovative type of fuel compared to uranium dioxide, which is the one that we typically use in the generation 3 reactors currently existing pretty much all over the world. The difference with uranium nitride fuel is, of course, it has some advantages compared to dioxide. That's why we are researching it. And first of all, it is compatible and a good candidate for small modular reactors. And that is because the uranium nitride has actually higher uranium density than uranium dioxide fuel. And this is simply because even from the chemical form, it is UO2, so means for two atoms of oxygen, one has one atom of uranium. However, for uranium nitride, which is UN, it is 50% uranium, 50% nitrogen. So in total, higher mass of fissile material, material that can produce energy for the same volume of fuel, which is already quite positive. Another good feature of uranium nitride fuel is the fact that it has good thermal conductivity, means that when it heats up, it can very efficiently dissipate that heat in the coolant, which will therefore basically turn water into steam, turn the steam turbines and produce electricity. So it does that in a more efficient way than uranium dioxide does. However, in the comments was also mentioned that, which is actually the case, since it is not an oxide fuel, it is prone to oxidation, which is a problem with this fuel in particular. However, since this fuel is not really considered at the moment for generation 3 reactors that run on water, that problem is not that big for reactors, for example, such as lead cold reactors, which is the ones I am researching. And there, basically, your coolant is liquid metal, which in this case is lead, could also be sodium. And there's no danger of oxidation since no water is present. However, in light water reactors, this would be the case. And of course, additional research and work must be done in order for this kind of fuel to be able to be used in light water reactors. Okay, so the next question, which I also got quite a lot, is how do you enrich uranium? Basically, by enrichment, what we mean is that the naturally occurring uranium is in the majority, uranium-238 is 99.3%, and only 0.7% is uranium-235. And the uranium-235, this very small percentage, less than 1%, is the one that is actually useful for light water reactors. It's the one that fissions with neutrons that are thermal, that are produced inside a light water reactor. And therefore, since this percentage is already so small when the uranium is naturally occurring, if the uranium undergoes a process called enrichment, in which the percentage of this uranium-235 is increased in order for the fuel to be more efficient and can be used inside the reactor core for a longer time. The enrichment process can be any of three, basically, most popular processes. However, the one that is the most known and probably the most used one is called centrifuge, and it is basically a cylinder in which uranium is spinning very fast. And during this centrifuge force, the uranium-235 can be separated from the uranium-238 just because it is a little bit lighter. Therefore, the 238 is attaching itself to the wall, the uranium-235 is staying pretty much into the center of the cylinder, and therefore can be extracted and be in a more concentrated form and can be mixed with fuel that will therefore become pellets and used inside the reactor. Having said that, it is important to note that this process is necessary for reactors that use thermal neutrons, so neutrons that have low energy, because in this energy spectrum of neutrons, the uranium-235 is the one that will cause the most fission and the most probability to fission inside the reactor core. Fast neutrons could also fission with uranium-238, which is, as we said, the 99.3% of the naturally occurring uranium. And therefore, if a reactor is designed to use fast neutrons, it can fission naturally occurring uranium that doesn't need enrichment. And this is one of the ideas for small modular reactors and generation 4 designs to be used in the future in order to be able to utilize the most amount of the uranium we can from the naturally occurring uranium. Moving on to the next question is, how about depleted uranium, the radiation compared to natural uranium? What makes it dangerous, etc.? So actually, depleted uranium is uranium that has either underwent through the enrichment process and has been taken out because the uranium-235 has been extracted out of it, and it is actually less dangerous than the natural uranium metal would be, and that is because there is isotopes inside the depleted uranium that are now missing, such as the uranium-235. Therefore, depleted uranium, as we said, is pretty much less harmless than natural uranium is, and would consequently have a lower dose than the natural uranium has. So this was the first Q&A video regarding lab questions that you guys asked in the previous video. I hope you enjoyed it. Let me know what you thought in the comments down below. And if you have additional questions, make sure to leave them in the comments so I can make a future video about them. Don't forget to like and subscribe and turn on the bell notification icon. It's been Elina, your friendly nuclear physicist. And until next time, see you soon.